Okay. Well, welcome to FOSDEM, and thank you all for making it for a 9:30 talk on Saturday after a beer event. I am fairly sure those 30 minutes in bed were extremely, extremely tempting. They were so for me as well, even though I didn't go to the beer event. But as you all know, FOSDEM is well worth it, and I will now show you exactly why. Much like every year, FOSDEM has a ton of content. There are 350 hours of content, as a matter of fact, given by more than 600 speakers. The variety is staggering. You could be interested in law. You could be interested in software engineering. You could be interested in engineering communities. You could be interested in some random project that I haven't heard of. That is entirely possible. I am sure you will find, if not a talk, a dev room, a stand, a poster, you will find somebody else here in between the thousands and thousands of people that attend FOSDEM that will share your passion. In addition to the standard conference folder of talks and lightning talks, FOSDEM also has stands, 56 of them as a matter of fact, and the projects are extremely, extremely excited to see you. There is some awesome swag, so I would suggest you make your way to the stands as soon as you possibly can. There are also more than 40 dev rooms. They cover, again, a vast variety of topics. There's a dev room for Python, a dev room for Ruby. Those ones of you that have been here before know that the Python and Ruby dev rooms get full extremely fast. And then some very wonderful volunteers will put up a room full sign in front of them. That means don't enter. No, seriously, don't enter a room if there's a sign that says room full. That is for your own safety. That is for our safety. We don't want to be breaking the law and potentially breaking our necks. FOSDEM doesn't yet defy the laws of physics. In addition to all of these more scheduled events, there is a hack space where you can go and hack. There is a community corner where you can post jobs and also announcements. And of course, there is lots of space to just sit around and chat to other people. In addition to all of this, there are some birds of a feather rooms. Some of them need to be booked in advance, going to the FOSDEM.org submit link. Some of them you can book at info desks. These are rooms where you can, if you have a small project that you have all of the people here, like 5 or 6 people, and you want to have a little unconference or conference or however you want to call it, you can book the room and you can occupy it for the time you have booked it. FOSDEM likes to give you all the options in the world. There is so much content that you're very likely to want to clone yourself at some point. I have, definitely. I assure you there is no need. All of the talks will be recorded. All of the talks are live streamed. So if, say, on Sunday morning, you're too tired or too hungover and can't make your way to the conference, then that's fine. We have you covered. You can just tune in and watch any talk you like that is being live streamed. Or if you want to watch more than one talk at the same time, then it will be recorded and the videos will be up soon. Every year we say soon, and it truly is soon, I promise. We don't know exactly when, but it's going to be soon. There have been some amendments to the schedule due to some misunderstandings between us and ULB. The most important one is that the strategy for development outreach dev room has moved. It has moved from room AW1124 to room UD2119. Your schedules, the booklets do not reflect that, but the website online does, and so will any mobile app you have conjured up to use to visit FOSDEM. The Wi-Fi. So, FOSDEM is slightly opinionated about, okay, very opinionated about this. The main FOSDEM Wi-Fi is IPv6 only, and if your device doesn't support IPv6, then you need to go to FOSDEM Ancient. Now, we've called it Ancient because we really don't want you to be using that. IPv4 is old, we're running out of addresses, and the FOSDEM networking team does not want to deal with all of that. So, this is a message directly from the FOSDEM networking team. They encourage you, if your device does not support IPv6, to go and bang on the head of whoever is responsible, particularly if they are at this conference. So if your Debian operating system doesn't support IPv6, go to the Debian stand and tell them about it. Or, as a matter of fact, hang there until they fix it. I don't actually encourage that, but the idea is that we really want to be moving forward in the future. We've had IPv6 for long enough. Your devices truly should support them. Please. Right. This is blurrier than I intended it to be, but it will have to do. We are currently in Building J, the blue building down at the bottom left. The main info desk is found in Building K, that is directly diagonally from the car park, the white building. You can't miss it. If you happen to miss it, you can try nav.fosdem.org. We are trialing this out. It should be possible to say I am at stand Debian and I want to go to stand whatever in AW, and it should be able to give you directions. Now, I say should. This is new. This is the first time, this year, the first year we're trialing it out. If it doesn't work, please use the well-established method of asking somebody, whether they're in an orange t-shirt, in a yellow t-shirt, or just another attendee. I'm sure two heads over a map can figure out how to go across a car park. You're all smart people. When lunchtime rolls around, you would like to head to the lunchtime icons on Avenue Paul Heger. There are going to be food trucks there, and also opposite U building, there is a little cafe if you particularly want to sit and have some cafe food as opposed to food trucks. I don't know why you would want to do that, but if you do. FOSDEM staff in particular have a special request for you when it comes to food. Volunteers don't get a special food service. We use the same one you do. If you see somebody in a Helping FOSDEM t-shirt, orange, red, blue, yellow, if you can bear with us as well, please let them jump the queue. I know, I live in the UK. I would be the first person to tut at behavior like that. However, we usually have very little time to grab lunch, and it would be wonderful, wonderful if you could give us way. We promise we're not going to hog the queue for very long. We're just going to go grab it and go. Some more map things. Shuttle buses can be caught from Avenue Adolphe Bühl right up there. Their schedule is in your booklets. And booklets you can find at any info desk. There are two info desks, one at K and one at H. If you are rather lazy and don't want to go up the car park, it's just next door. Or maybe there, I'm not entirely sure. But somewhere near this building. Speaking of info desks, they also have feedback forms if you would like to give feedback for the conference. They also have booklets, they have schedules, they have maps, and they have wonderful people that are there to help you experience the conference as much as possible. Right, and here comes the money. You can't have a conference like FOSDEM without somebody actually footing the bill. And you're not the ones footing it, as you're well aware. This is very important to FOSDEM. FOSDEM wants to remain free. However, our attitude towards wanting free things doesn't extend to food and printers and beer, indeed, as I'm sure you're aware, even though we would much like it to. So I would like you to give some cheer to our cornerstone sponsors, Red Hat and Google. And of course, keep up the momentum for Cisco Cloud Native Computing Foundation, CodeThinkCode, GitHub, Hewlett-Packard Enterprise, Minio, MySQL, and of course O'Reilly, who have an amazing book stand right next door in H. And naturally, year after year after year, ULB graciously give us the campus, even though they know what we do with it. So I would like you very much to thank ULB for what they do. However, FOSDEM's biggest sponsor is not on these slides. That's because you are FOSDEM's biggest sponsor. Year after year, you are the ones that actually fund most of this conference through your wonderful donations. And again, as year after year, this year we will take donations, and for a certain sum, you will get something back. For 25 euros, you will get a t-shirt. This time it's gray with pink. That's not because I'm the first speaker. I didn't have any input in the color, I promise. For 50 euro, you can get a t-shirt or a hoodie. We're trialing the hoodies, they're going out fast, so if you want to grab one, better head to the InfoDesk K, and also an O'Reilly pocketbook. And for 100 euro, you get a t-shirt and an O'Reilly book. It's usually the standard fodder, but please do, because really, you're the reason we can pay for all this stuff. And speaking of what you can do for us, I have a few requests. please try to keep the spaces you occupy clean. This is Belgium, so naturally the house elves are on strike. We can't use them, they refuse to clean. That means we have to clean. So what, anything you leave under your seat, on the stairs, somewhere in a corner, a staff member or a volunteer will have to pick up. So please, leave as few things as possible. As I asked before, give way to volunteers. That doesn't only go for food. We're usually in a hurry, usually don't see anything else, and probably won't hear you if we're staff because somebody's shouting in our earpiece. That's definitely what's going on. So if you see a volunteer or a staff member rushing to somewhere, please make sure you give way. Give us feedback. Not only can you give feedback for the conference itself, but for any talk you see, you can go to the talks page and give feedback to the individual speaker and the individual talk. We do go through the feedback and we do improve. Well, try to. But we truly, truly take inspiration from everything you give back, including the feedback. And of course, you can definitely become a volunteer yourself. And I realized that I did not make it sound like glamorous work, picking up garbage. And as a matter of fact, this is my first time giving a talk in this auditorium, and my first thought was, those network cables stuck to the stairs were a pain last time I had to remove them. But you do have to. Somebody has to clean up for them after the event. As I said, the only thing UOB asks of us is that we come, and we leave no trace. One time we left the big Fosdem sign on the building key. But other than that, we try not to leave any trace of Fosdem. If you could help with cleanup, perhaps you're pottering around in Brussels on Sunday evening, don't have anything to do, we would love to have you. You can never have too many hands at cleanup, as my wonderful volunteer manager colleague will tell you. Also, heralding or signage on Sunday morning. Please don't leave another wonderful colleague of mine here to do the signage by himself on Sunday morning. He will do it, but then he'll grumble. So please, somebody help him. And also heralding tomorrow, lightning talks. If you want to see a lightning talk, why not try to moderate? It takes not much more than just lifting a few signs and making sure the speaker's laptop is connected. Please. And just in case I am not making Fosdem volunteering sound like the most glamorous job in the world, or like hard work for very little payoff, I would like to explain why you only have half the story right. It is definitely hard work, but the payoff is incalculable. And here I'm going to tell you why, or how I came to stand here, even though for most of my life I had no clue how to write anything more than, I don't know, I actually never opened a command line on Windows. Who would, anyway? So once upon a time, there was a woman programmer in the 90s. She worked with Fortran and COBOL and was responsible for a payment system in a big tourist resort in Bulgaria. She was paid half of what every male colleague she was equal to in rank was paid. That was definitely explained to her was because she was a woman and she could leave at any point, so there was no point investing. Regardless, she was the one that knew the system best and spent countless hours on weekends and in the evenings debugging and fixing under very stressful situations with very short deadlines. She would be the one blamed if something was broken, even though she had five other colleagues. The stress of that job was such that when that woman fell pregnant with her second child, she reevaluated her priorities. She was good at her job, she loved the work, but she hadn't seen her first child on a weekend for years. So, with that in mind, when her second child was born, she gave up the job. She gave up programming for good. That woman is my mother. She has no idea I'm telling this story and is going to be watching this. Hi, Mom. Yes. Thank you. These applauses are really for her. For a very long time, computers were downright banned in my household. My father bought one contraband and didn't tell her. He did it at work when she found out. Anyway, you're glad you weren't there. But I grew up without computers for a very long time, and then when I had one, I was only allowed 1 hour a day. Programming was downright banned. There was no way a child of my mother's was going to become a programmer. She had two daughters. She did not think programming was fit for a woman. It was just not going to happen. When I first came to Folsdam, I was just finishing a psychology degree. I came here as part of a group, and I had no interest in software, so I volunteered for the whole conference. I did build up on Friday, info desk Saturday, Sunday, and then clean up on Sunday. I was shattered. But also, 1 week afterwards, I applied for a master's in computing, and here I am. Yes, the code. Thank you. The call to my mother was rather awkward, though. There was 3 minutes of silence on roaming. So, yes, she's now very happy that I do what I do, and I am immensely happy. I have never been happier in my life. I love this community. I met Folsdam staff. I was incredibly inspired to continue. And as you can see, now I'm part of Folsdam staff. They decided they wanted me to do more work, because that's what happens when you're a good volunteer. You will get more work. Be a good volunteer. So, yes, volunteering for Folsdam is difficult, but it is incredibly rewarding, and you never know what you'll get out of it. I can't promise that it will change your life, but please look at it as an opportunity. It is not a chore. It is definitely an opportunity. Speaking of me being here at this conference, I would like to remind you all that Folsdam has a code of conduct. Please familiarize yourselves with it. It is the best code of conduct I have seen, and I have read a few. It mostly tells you what you should do. We want everybody to feel welcome, and we want everybody to feel engaged. Please make sure that you behave appropriately. I'm sure you know. Please put your best foot forward. And on a slightly sadder note, at the end of last year, our community lost one of its prominent members. Peter Hinchins was a force of nature, and he was a big part of open source, and he was a big part of our community. There is a memorial service to him at 6 p.m. today in room K1105. Please go there and remember him with the others that knew him and loved him for the force of nature that he was, and for all he contributed to our community and to software overall. I would like to leave you with this quote by Peter Hinchins, and I would like you to keep it at the back of your mind throughout the conference. This is what Folsdam is about. We strive for diversity, openness, and broad tolerance. Most of what we teach and learn comes through informal channels. We're smashing the barriers of distance, wealth, background, gender, and age. This is what he was all about. This is what Folsdam is all about. Please. Continue being amazing. My being here and giving this talk is important and unbelievable to me. But can you imagine how important and unbelievable it is to the 50-year-old woman watching this in Bulgaria? Thank you so much for making Folsdam amazing.